Welcome to Gracefully Graying. I'm your host, Attorney Henry Gornvine. Please go to the Henry Gornvine YouTube channel to see all of the Gracefully Graying podcasts. And also visit our website that is in the process of being built, gracefullygraying.com. Also tell all of your friends about this. Today on Gracefully Graying, I'm pleased to welcome Dr. Ronald Craig as we discuss kind of a topic that's important that we haven't covered yet, and that is empty nesting. Ronna, welcome to Gracefully Graying.
Thank you, Henry.
First of all, you suggested the topic of empty nesting. Why don't you tell us what you mean by empty nesting?
Sure. I think most people really understand what the term empty nesting is, but basically it's when your children leave the house either because they're getting a job or because they're heading off to college.
And the dog's gone as well, or?
In my case, actually, yes. So it's a time when it's a couple that has had children, or sometimes even a single person that has been rearing their child. You know, they're faced with dealing with life without dealing with all of the day-to-day issues and jobs that it takes to be raising a child. So it's a time of transition, and for many people, transitions can be both good and difficult. So, but definitely in my field of psychology, transitions are a place where we tend to focus and help people move on to the next step in a graceful and positive way.
And how do you do this? Because in my divorce practice, I've seen a lot of people where the children are gone and they're facing the next chapter of life, and if they're not on the same page, you start having problems.
Absolutely. So, first of all, I would say that if you wait until the day that the children, and typically what we're talking about is heading off to college or move out, if you're waiting till that day, it's probably a little late, because what you want to do is kind of start setting the stage at some point for not having the children around. And children are great. They can be a focus for a couple or even a parent, and they can also be a distraction. And so what we want to do is prepare for whatever it is that we want to do in the next stage, because our main focus has left us.
And how do you help them do this?
So first of all, I work with a lot of people who whose children are about at that phase. And often, well, one thing is, husbands or fathers and mothers often approach this a little bit differently. Often the father is kind of ready to have the little nestlings out
yes,
of the nest.
Trying to fly.
And, right, and mom has often, not all the time, built her life much more so around the children. So while father is looking at it as an opportunity, you know, hey, great, we can, you know, have more independence and be on our own, mom can see it really as a time of loss and as a time of grieving and as a time of lack of direction. So a couple things. First of all, we would talk with a couple, or at least with one of the partners, about starting to talk to their other partner about how are we going to do this, and what do we want to do, and how can we reconnect, and you know, how do we want this next phase of our lives to look? And again, it's a good idea to start this maybe when your last child is a sophomore or a junior in high school. If you leave it, again, to the day they leave, mom's on the couch sobbing, and dad approaches her, and she's having none of the planning at that point.
But how many people think that far ahead? I mean, it's like in our daily lives, we're enmeshed in the fact, you know, there are different phases, and you're raising children, you're carpooling, you're balancing one or two jobs and all these things, and before you know it, they're gone.
Sure. I mean, some people do. Some people are very focused on planning ahead. Some people aren't. My job is, if people are starting to go through the grieving process, let's say when their child is, you know, a sophomore or junior, my job is to say, how about we start thinking about this process? So I actually have a funny story. I have a very close friend whose child literally just left for college a couple months ago. And she started thinking about this a couple years ahead. So what she decided to do was pick something really easy to do, like opening a restaurant. And she calls that her new baby. So that's a pretty extreme example of trying to find something to do. But I talk to people about considering, you know, for people who haven't been working, how to get back to work. If they have been working, are they satisfied in their job, or do they want to find a change? Another point is that it's an opportunity. If you think about the focus of our time when our children are at home, a majority of the focus of the time is on the children and the household, and often work. What I like to talk to people about is, how do you want your time to look? So we'll often do a pie chart, two pie charts. One is, what does my time schedule look like right now? Am I spending 50% of my time on my children and then 25% of my time on self-care and, you know, whatever it is? But what would you like it to look like? And then what we try to do is focus on, how do we get from what it is to what I want it to be at the next phase.
So you help them with a major transition in life.
Absolutely.
From, you know, spending a lot of time raising and managing children to, you know, what do I want to do with the rest of my life?
Exactly.
What about the situation, and more you have empty nesters where children leave and they come back? Welcome, or do you move and leave no forwarding address?
Right. That is a pretty common situation these days. It's not unusual. And I think first of all, I think many parents are sort of prepared for that, that possibility will happen again, because it seems like the launching phase of our children, adolescents, whatever, keeps getting older and older and older. But I think when an adult child comes back to the nest, it's really important for everybody involved to have a pretty clear idea of what to expect. So again, I'm all about planning. So sit down with your child before they move back in. Let's say it's the last semester of college and they're about to start on a new job, or they don't have a job and they need to be looking for a job, but they're moving home. Let's, you know, sit down with the child and talk about, what do you expect? Do you expect to be eating dinners with us every night? Do you expect, you know, me to be doing your laundry? Do you expect that I'm paying for your car? Do you expect that you should be home by your old curfew at midnight, or can you stay out all night?
These are tough questions.
They're really tough questions. Do you expect that you can bring people back to the house with you to stay overnight? You know, and every family has their own rules, and every person has their own rules and expectations. And it's really important to talk about all of those, so everybody is on the same page, everybody kind of understands what the expectation is. And at the very least, you talk about it. Ideally, you even create a contract about it. This is what is expected, this is what is not going to be allowed. And the other thing that I also suggest is meeting a month or two or three after that to talk about how it's working. So you don't just leave it like, this is the contract, here's what we expect. Things are going to be difficult, parts of the contract are going to be broken, so let's revisit it and talk about how this is working.
So you're really working with them on a kind of a continuing basis to help them establish this new dynamic, for lack of a better word.
Exactly. And then the other thing to consider in that matter is boundaries. Like, how involved would I as a parent be with my adult child relative to how involved I was with whatever aspect of their life?
How do you deal with helicopter parents who don't want to let go or can't let go?
Right. it's definitely a challenge. And, you know, you really want to help them see that their child, their children's independence, or their child being independent, is good for the child. It's so making it be a gift that they can give to their child, as opposed to feeling like, if I don't do my son's laundry, he's gonna, you know, not be able to survive.
So he'll be dirty for a while.
Exactly, and then he'll learn.
How about helping spouses reconnect? Because it's a major transition.
Absolutely. I think that, you know, when you're raising your children, again, they can be a distraction, and one spouse, often it's, what is my husband, a zone defense, or man to man.
Well, everyone's running in different directions.
Everybody's running in different directions, right.
That's a lot of moving parts.
Right, right. So when it's time for the kids to be gone and the parents to reconnect, it's really important to try to identify some new things that each person wants to do. I kind of go by the yours, mine, and ours philosophy.
Okay.
Which is you, the husband, has your interests. I, the wife, have my interests. And then we should have some our interests. And often that's really difficult to figure out what those our interests should be. So one of the things I have couples do as an exercise would be each of them separately write down some of the things that they might be interested in doing or even willing to do, okay? And then we compare and we see like a Venn diagram when there's two circles where they overlap. What's the common area, okay? So let's say they both say they like art, okay? So maybe we, you know, start going to the DIA once a month to, or when we're on vacations, we make sure we go to an art institute, or we plan a vacation around an art institute, something like that. Or if they're both interested in, I want to exercise more, that might be an area where they can do that together.
Sure.
So let's find a type of exercise that we both can enjoy. And so there, it's also very important, the husband has to have his own life and his own interests. The wife has to have her own life and her own interests. But it's very important when you're trying to connect to have some common interests.
What if the husband has a full career and the wife has been more of a stay-at-home mom? Is that going to be a more difficult transition than where both are fully active in the work community?
Not necessarily, because a stay-at-home mom can also be a very, very, very busy person.
That's true.
And she can also be very busy, not necessarily with her kids. But I do think that it's generally just really important for people to, if there's a hole in their lives, if there's a vacuum, to try and fill it with things that enrich and nurture them. So the husband, let's say, has had this, you know, full-time job and he's very busy, and at this point it's up to the wife, who has probably been more focused on the child, to start developing some of her own interests that are not necessarily in having him involved because he's busy. So I also, one of my philosophies is, let's experiment. Okay, let's try stuff out. So in this particular case, I would probably have somebody write a list of, let's say, 10 things that they might be interested in. And then they rank them, and then they start at the top. You know, I've always been interested in learning how to dance. I'm gonna go take a dance class. I've, you know, been interested in sailing. I'm gonna go see if there's a, you know, some sort of sailing program over on Lake St. Clair. Starting to develop your own interests. The other thing is, I always suggest trying to kill more than two birds with one stone, or at least two birds with one
stone.
Tell
me what you mean by that.
It's not the best analogy. But what I mean by that is, we have different areas that we need to focus on in our lives. So one is developing friendships and interpersonal relationships.
Sure.
Another is, as we get older, exercising can be very important to keeping us young and vital.
Absolutely.
Another might be wanting to give back, you know, sort of giving to the community in some way. So if you can hit on at least two of those, so if you're going to exercise with a friend, okay? If you're going to do some volunteer work and you see that I need to build up my social life, what you don't want to be doing is stuffing envelopes in your home. What you want to be doing is going to an office or working with people on a board so that you're doing something good and at the same time increasing your social sphere.
Makes a lot of sense, because I know in gracefully growing, one thing I'm learning is that people tend to become more and more isolated as we age, and loneliness is a big factor.
Absolutely.
Let's talk about a situation where empty nesters, let's say they're in their early 50s, children are in college or out of college, mm-hmm. but they don't have common goals and mm-hmm. they can't intersect. Mm-hmm. What happens there?
Yeah. Well, that is unfortunately a too real situation. There's so many couples that stick together and that they even say, we're going to stay together for the children. And then when the children leave the nest, they decide that it's time for them to leave each other. So,
and that's common. I mean, yeah, I see a lot of in my practice, and
sure.
I call, in fact, I'm lecturing on that, the gray divorce. Mm-hmm. So,
yeah, yeah, it's a really, really difficult thing to do. Typically, for at least one of the partners. Sometimes there's a partner that is driving that, but it's still a really sad and difficult situation. And I think one of the hardest parts is even though these people, the couple, they don't get along, they still have their children in common, and it really will disrupt the entire family. So where are we going to go for Christmas? All the typical Christmas rituals that they have, and you know, the children, even though they're not in the house anymore, can be really affected by it. So. It is difficult, but people have to overcome it and come out the other side. So often it can involve a spouse returning to work or changing what they do because they need to get more income. Often it is dealing with the children and how they're going to manage it. It's a very sad situation.
It's a huge transition, and it's a huge area that has tremendous economic ramifications, legal ramifications. We're not going to go there now, but the next question I have is, what about empty nesters when there isn't a spouse, where it's just either they've been divorced or there's a death and there's just one parent?
Mm-hmm. Again, I think a lot of the challenges are similar, but with empty nesting when there is a spouse, one of the major goals is to reconnect with your spouse. If you don't have a spouse to connect with, often parents are facing a lot of loneliness, a very quiet house, grieving, in a sense of, what am I going to do with myself? So again, I suggest getting busy, trying to find something that inspires you or that you have passion for, in some ways finding a new baby. And again, trying to hit those more than, you know, one bird with one stone kind of thing. So time for many people is very limited. And so how can we maximize the time that we invest and get the most out of it? So again, if you want to, let's say, meet somebody, you know, romantically, of course there's online dating, but another thing to do would be to work at or volunteer or become involved in something where there's an opportunity to meet people that you might want to get involved with.
So these are all really dealing with loneliness and how you have basically an antidote for that. But mm-hmm. you mentioned online dating. Let's
yes.
talk about dating. I mean, mm-hmm. someone who's been married, let's say 25, 30 years, and suddenly either because of a great divorce or because of a loss of a spouse through death, is out there.
Mm-hmm.
It's a different world.
It is a different world. Yeah, yeah.
So what do you advise people there?
So
be careful, maybe.
Be careful, that's the first thing.
In many respects.
Right. It can be really daunting for people because this was not your grandfather's Buick.
No.
So a lot of people describe online dating as a job in and of itself.
Why?
Because even for some sites, it can take a couple hours to upload your information. And then often if you get a lot of responses, it's perusing those responses and making a decision about whether you want to follow up on those responses or not. And then if you do follow up, then it's having some sort of conversation. And literally, people describe this as a second job, which can be good or bad, but then there's also the pitfalls of, you know, trying to be safe and being careful.
Well, how do you sort the truth from fiction? Because people tend to put their best foot forward, or
right.
they can lie, or they can,
sure.
you know, it's right. a scary world out there.
It
and
is.
I deal a lot in that in my family law practice where, you know, there's so much lack of candor, for lack of a better
right.
word.
So I recommend a couple of things. One of the main things, and this is hard, I think, for older people to do, which is to take their time. You know, often we want to be in a relationship. We feel like this is not our first rodeo, and we feel like we're capable of knowing pretty quickly who this person is that we're spending time with.
Is that true?
No, it's not true. So I really, and believe me, I see this a lot. So what I recommend is take your time, let the relationship unfold. Relationships have to unfold. There is no other way to get to know somebody than by spending a lot of time with them, and that cannot be rushed. The other thing is, typically in relationships, and I don't care if you're 50 or 70 or 25, is we can always put our best foot forward.
Sure.
For 6 months or so, and then some of our less good feet start
to... Well, I would say it's like you're on trial, so to speak. You're putting your best foot forward.
Yeah.
Then you get married, or you start living together, and everything starts to unravel.
Right.
It's like peeling an onion. You got to get a lot of layers off.
When you're first dating somebody and you're excited, you have a lot of energy, and you can put that energy into doing all the right things. But as we get more comfortable, we don't have quite so much energy to do the right thing. The other thing that happens in relationships is as we have history, we start to make up our own stories. So let's say you and I are dating, and the very first time you show up on time, and the second time you're a half an hour late, and you say, oh, there was an accident, and I'm, oh, he's so cute, whatever.
It's a lie.
Could be a lie,
could
but
be.
Even if it was the truth, but let's just say, you know, then the next 20 times we date, you're late all the time. Now I know what to expect, and then I make up my own stories about it, like he doesn't value my time, or he's a liar, or any of those things might be true or they might not be true, but experience teaches us those things. So the more time we take, the more time we have to learn what to expect from another person.
Well, the other thing, we all have our issues,
mm-hmm.
and I think as we get older, aren't we less tolerant of accepting someone else's garbage or baggage, so to speak? We all have baggage, but...
I think in some ways we're less tolerant because we can probably become more rigid as we get older, but maybe in some ways we're actually more tolerant because we know we have our own issues.
Right.
By the time you're 50 or 55, you've got a lot of things that have happened in your life, both good and bad.
True.
So we do have maybe more empathy that
hopefully,
is,
yeah.
Hopefully.
Yeah.
Not always, but hopefully. Yeah.
So dating is a challenge. New relationships could be a challenge.
Yes.
And more and more people, especially older people, they don't get married.
Right.
They live together. You see on a death notice, someone deceased and someone significant other or
mm-hmm.
loving companion,
mm-hmm.
so
mm-hmm.
it's
yeah.
more and more common.
Sure, sure. Yeah, people, they're trying to protect their children and their assets. I know of one couple who, they got married in the church, but they are not legally married. So they feel like they're married in a way that's important to them, but it doesn't combine their assets.
We're down to 3 minutes, believe it or not.
Wow.
We're
going
to do another show because we have a lot more to talk about, but let's go to another topic.
Sure.
How do we deal with aging parents?
That is another big challenge. So it's kind of like the kids are out and the aging parents are in. And in some ways, when you don't have to focus on your children as much, it actually frees you up to take care of your aging parents. So in some ways that can be a relief that you have more time to deal with your aging parents. It's not nearly as much fun to see, you know, the decline in health as
it's hard.
It's hard.
And the aging parent is not the same person who he or she was, you know, sometimes 5 years ago, 10 years ago, or even last year. There
right.
can be dramatic changes, especially if you're dealing with serious illness or if you're dealing with lack of cognitive issues.
Absolutely. This is another case where I recommend trying to have some limits and boundaries around this so that your entire life isn't sucked up with dealing with your aging parent. I mean, it's hard enough to go from the stage of having a you know, big filled home to having a lot of quiet, but then to go straight into now I have to take care of my parents, which is not always a lot of fun.
No.
It's good to have a balance, which means you devote time to your parents, but you also make sure that you carve out time to take care of yourself.
I think that's critical because for caregivers, there's a lot of burnout.
Mm-hmm.
And if you don't take care of yourself, then you're not any good to, if there's a spouse or the children or to the aging parents, ultimately.
Right. Yeah, if you're depressed and can't get out of bed, you're not going to be a whole lot of help to your parent who needs to be taken weekly to the doctor or, you know, have their finances taken care of or whatever it is. So
we're down to 1 minute. I'd like to give us maybe three takeaways before we sign off, and then this is a conversation to be continued because there's a lot there.
Okay. First of all, I think trying to... When you're empty nesting, it's a great time to start over in some ways and devote the time in your life to things that you enjoy. So identifying what those are and finding a balance between the different demands in your life. So me time, couple time, family time, work time, spiritual time, parents, aging parents time, but trying to find that right balance. Reconnecting with your spouse, if you have a spouse, is so important at this stage. And it can be fun. It can be really a great adventure. And so identifying and continuing to talk with your spouse about what's working, what's not, what we envision, what we would like for our future together. Those are really important things.
These are important. Dr. Ronald Smith Craig, who is an excellent therapist, by the way, we're out of time. I want to thank you so much for being my guest on Gracefully Graying, and I want to thank you for watching Gracefully Graying. Again, please follow us on the Henry Gornbein YouTube channel. Thank you.